God.
Yes.
One of the things that I appreciate most about God's people is being able to pray one for another. Mm-hmm. You know, when we're not able to be here working and, you know, I can feel your prayers. I mean, I deal in trucks and how just God protects you. And I was thinking a lot about that this week. And one of the things that helps me keep focused is when somebody sees a trait in you and they make a statement about it, and you realize years ago you struggled with that same. You know, when I just heard, you know, well, Tim, you know, you have a patience of a saint. You know, you have a patience. And I'm thinking, I remember that wasn't the case years ago. It was just the opposite. There wasn't much patience there. But when you see how God, where he's brought you from, that's why we can declare in Psalms 139, verse 14, I will confess and praise you, for you are fearful and wonderful, for the awful wonder of my birth. Wonderful are your works, and that my inner self knows right well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being formed in secret and intricately, curiously wrought, as if embroidered with various colors in the depths of the earth, a region of darkness and mystery. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book, all the days of my life were written before ever they took shape, when as yet there was none of them. How precious and weighty also are your thoughts to me, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I could count them, they would be more in number than the sand. When I awoke, could I count to the end, I will still be with you. We never want to forget how fearfully and wonderfully we're made.
Yes.
You know, how God created us. I love it when it says in Ephesians, and this is from the New Living Translation. I really love some of the other translations because they kind of bring it out. Ephesians 2:10, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the things he planned for us long ago. How powerful is that?
Amen.
We are God's masterpiece. God loves us so much. We should never forget that. Years ago, I was in a Walmart store, and this little kid, he was in a stroller. And, you know, parents put T-shirts on the kid. And this one, I could see that little kid's face. He was smiling. And he had his T-shirt. He said, when God made me, he was just showing off. I thought, hallelujah.
Yeah.
I never forgot that. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that's how much God loves us, you know.
Yeah.
He loves his kids. You know, and think about where God has brought you from. You know, we think about Genesis 1:27. So God created man his own image. Isn't that important? Realize God, we're reflecting God. He created us in the image of God, created him male and female. Create, think about create, to bring something to existence. Synonyms, produce, generate, bring into being. Think about when your life, before you knew Christ, and where you are now in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible said, you know, all things become new. The old things are passed away. And a lot of us, that's what we need to do. Let those old things be passed away. The Bible says all things become new.
Yes.
Now, one thing it doesn't say is become new instantly. You ever notice that? Because it's a process.
Yes.
And we're always learning every single day. And those situations we haven't got, like when I was growing up, and as I was becoming being a Christian, more like Christ, one person said, you know, Tim, every day, you know, we got these tests, we go to school. You know, we got these things that happen in life, we're learning. And I told him one day I was going through some stuff. I said, well, I'm flunking the test today. I ain't doing very good. But you know what? The next round, I'm going to pass it. The next round, I'm going to be better. When I fail, I'm getting up. There's an old Eastern proverb said, if you fall down seven times, get up eight. You know,
Yeah. You're
going to get up and keep going. And that's where Christ wants us to be. We got to realize whose we belong to. You know, that is so important to realize we belong, we are children of the King.
That's right.
Yes. And we belong to him.
Yes.
So he's going to look out for us. You know, he knows what's best. That's one thing we have to really, really understand. We really have to realize who we serve. So those situations in our life, if we could just say, pray before, God, you know, you give me favor. God, you provide the way. God, you open this door. Now, you know, one thing I found, God can open a door, but he expects us to walk through. Yeah. You know, if he opens that door, you know, people ought to say, well, Tim, I'd like to have a new career. I'd like to have a new job. Well, have you done anything to start that direction? Have you done anything? I've never once had a job where I stood outside the place and said, you know what? I'd really like to work there. I really like it. And somebody says, you know what? You've probably been thinking you like to work here. You know? I think I'll hire you right now. How many times does that happen?
Yeah.
Have you even put in an application?
Yeah.
You know, have you even done your part? The older saints used to say this, when you make one step, God makes two. And I believe that. I believe that. Because God can tell you who to be with, who to marry. He can tell you what car to purchase, what car dealer to go, what grocery store. I tell you, my missus, we was walking in Walmart the other night.
Come on.
And I tell you, this is how God can bring in contact with people. So we was going looking for this item, and we was walking down the aisle, and suddenly this young lady, I think she was probably 18, 19, she just started talking. I thought at first she was talking to somebody else, because she was talking to maybe somebody else was in a different aisle. No, she started telling us about her life. How blessed it was. You know, she had her first apartment. She was paying her own rent. There was a smile, a beam, and she just starts sharing. You know, when I had my D-Mac shirt on, and she said, well, I think about going to D-Mac and doing nursing. You know, I want to do something with my life. It just poured out of her. And we never saw her before. And you know what we said? We're going to pray for her. We never see her again, but we're going to pray for her. We're going to believe there's going to be good things going to happen in her life. And we all need to do that. The one thing about it, we should never, ever run people down. For the simple reason, we don't know where their lives came from.
Right.
We don't know. A lot of times, well, I don't think that person's going to amount to nothing. You don't ever want to say that.
Right.
Because God takes those, you know, he takes those people that people, well, I don't think I can use them. I don't think they're going to amount to. Let's look at Moses. I'm always fascinated with Moses' life. You know, he kind of had an up and down. I mean, he really did. You know, he got put in a basket, you know, and then you know the story. And then he had to be gone. He had to be gone oh, thank you, man. You are so nice. Thank you. I have to drown this frog in my throat. I'm thank you. That is so nice. That's a kind heart. Thank you. That is so nice.
Amen.
But I always think of Moses. You know, because when he had to leave Egypt on the run, and 40 years, think about that. You know, the first few years, he probably thought, well, you know, we'll get, you know, God will use me. But just think about the first decade.
Yeah.
Man, I don't know, man. This is getting pretty bad. I'm on the backside of the desert. I had all that luxury. I had all this, you know, learned under Pharaoh and all this stuff. And now, backside of the desert. Second decade, 20 years, oh man, I think God forgot about me. Ain't heard from my relatives. Third decade, now he really probably thinking about that. I'm done. God can't, 30 years, God ain't, I ain't heard from him. Ain't heard from my relatives. You know, he had some blessings out there, you know, he had a family. But then what happened? That 40th year. Burning bush. But Moses didn't, you know, the bush wasn't burned. The Bible said he turned aside. He turned aside. God spoke to him. Because you know you can see what God was doing in that time.
Yeah.
You know, God has to take some things out of us too. You know, he got to take the things that are not reflective of him. And sometimes that takes some time. And he called Moses, and I always like how God calls you a lot of times in the Bible. He calls your name twice. And there probably wasn't too many Moses out there in the backside of death. So there wasn't no misunderstanding. But he knew. Moses, Moses. You know where he stands? It's holy ground. Because where God is, it's always holy ground. You know? And I tell you what, you're going to be the one going to lead my people up. You know? And I just look, me, how you going to use me? Because I'm not done with it yet. And I'm here tonight to tell you, God's not done with you yet either.
That's right.
70, 80 years, it doesn't make any difference to God counting the years. He can use anybody.
Amen.
He can use a little kid. He can use an older person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what he wants is a heart that's sold and dedicated to him.
Mm-hmm.
That's what God's want, and that's what he's looking for. He's got a plan. And I'm going to end with this, and we'll go to prayer. This is this. You know, sometimes people say something in the secular world, not necessarily Christian, but it's still, there's still something in there for you.
Sure.
God can use it. This is a quote I know you've heard before by Aaron Hansen. There is freedom in waiting for you on the breeze of the skies, and you ask, what if I fall? What if I fall? If I do this, what if I fall? But see, this is God's heart, this next part. But oh my darling, what if you fly? Oh,
yeah.
Hallelujah. And that's where God is saying,
yeah.
Hallelujah. You might look like, I can't do this, God. Well, I tell you what, I'm not asking you to do it. By yourself, I'm going to be with you. Because
yeah.
The Bible says, for with God.
Yeah.
For with God, all things are possible.
Amen.
Yes.
And the Bible said, is there anything? I love that. Is there anything too hard for God?
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. So we're going to open this floor up, prayer requests, testimonies. James wants us to pray for some needs there, and that's what we're here for. That's what we're here. We thank the Lord for you guys praying us, pulling that trailer around, because, you know, it was such a blessing. They gave us the best spot. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
The best spot. We got there real early Saturday morning, and we ran into Sunday morning, and he says, you know what? You got the best spot.
Amen.
We saved the best spot. We was there early. We said, you got the best spot. I said, hallelujah. Had the biggest trailer. That really helped out a lot. Let me tell you. You know? But it's stuff like that, you know, that you know God is there for you. To have God grant you favor, God open doors that nobody thought you could possibly open. And so tonight, that's what we're going to do. Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Thank
and I praise the Lord, my son, second oldest. God bless him with a bigger new house, you know?
Amen.
I mean, hallelujah. I just think that's great.
Yes.
When God blesses your kids, shoot.
Yes.
They got enough room to, you know, build a hockey rink, football, stadium in the back. You know, horses and cows and all that stuff back there. And I praise the Lord.
Yeah.
When your kids do well, you know, don't you? And that's what God wants said. You know what? When you get around and you haven't met, you know, you just maybe haven't seen people for a while, you know what the older people talk about? You know, now you talk about grandkids or your kids. You always talk about how well they do. God wants to say the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, look at my kid. I'm blessed. They're doing well. I'm proud of them.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what God wants us to do. We was talking about on the way over here that there's one thing that God wants to hear from us constantly is you appreciate him.
Yes, yes, yes.
Man, I mean, when you tell God, and you know, spend a day sometime or in your prayer time, and don't ask God for nothing. Just I'm just saying a suggestion. Just say, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Yes.
That's it. God, I didn't come here to ask you for anything today. I just come to say I love you and appreciate you.
Yes.
Amen.
That's what turns a person's life around when they appreciate you.
Uh-huh.
You know, appreciate what you've done. Not just what God did for you yesterday. It's what he's doing for you today and what he has planned for you tomorrow.
Yes.
Be thankful.
Amen.
Be thankful. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Someone else. James.
One of the things, I know we lost a good colleague in Christ, Jenny Hooper, that I've known. But one of the things I noticed about her is she had a never-ending love for anybody she touched.
Hallelujah.
And that's what I think we should do with Jesus, is to have that never-ending love, and just kind of like, remember a song in church we used to sing, it only takes a spark to get a fire going with.
Hallelujah.
On. And that's God's love through, he died eternal for us, and just to feel his love, his glory, his presence, and to really be thankful everywhere we go, and I echo that, because it's so important. And I looked at JD and then I seen her smile and I jammed with her, you know, and now she's gone. And it's like, and then that's what I told her family. Yeah, that never ending love that just was never ending. And God's love is never ending.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
So,
yeah.
Hallelujah. That's beautiful, Jane. And that's what you will never forget, how much God loves you. You know, some people's love kind of ebb and flow, you know, as long as everything's going good and smooth, you know, then they love you. And then if you say the wrong thing, then they don't love you. And then they love you again. And I'm glad God's love is not like that.
Amen.
That He loves us all the time. You know, and think about that. You know, with your kids, when you got a really good parent, whether the kid's bad or good, you still love them.
Amen.
You know, you hang in there with them. You're on your knees a lot with them. I remember one time years ago, the church my mom went to, I'd go down and visit her, and they would have prayer requests, and they'd pass it back, like our offering basket was like that, and you slip prayer requests in there, and then they bring them up to offering and pray for her. Well, if they was going down the road, and evidently, it didn't quite make it in the basket, and so I saw this piece of paper on there. So I just picked it up, and she had wrote on there, you know, pray for Buddy, who's my oldest brother, you know, and I just thought, wow. You know, and just, she's still praying for her kid.
Yeah.
Still praying. That mother on their knees, they've changed more lives than ever. Yeah. You know, we talk about the preachers and they all do good, but I'm telling you, to have somebody constantly pray, have your pastor pray, people in the parishioners pray, but have that mother down on their knees,
yeah,
and praying for their kids to do right. And sometimes they don't see it in this generation. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes they see it in the next generation. That their kid gets touched. I've seen a lot of people's lives change at a funeral. You know, that person's gone. I was part of my mom's funeral, and I spoke for the family, and I remember at the pulpit, and they had the casket open, and I'm looking down, and I said, goodbye, Mom, for just a while.
Yeah.
You know what? I know I'm going to see you one day.
Right.
The reason is because you taught me about Jesus Christ.
Yes.
That's why I have that hope.
Yes.
So I look down there, and I realize you're up there. That's just the body right there.
Yeah.
And so I can always look forward to that time with Mom so we can have a reconciliation up there.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, that you can sit at Mom's feet and tell you what, Mom, I love you. I love you. I love you. And just think about it. They used to talk about God's rocking chair. You know, I remember people talk about that. And one night it's like a vision where you saw this big rocking chair and people was lined up. And everybody was taking their turn. Jesus was rocking. It's like He loves you that much, and it talks about in the Bible, He rejoiced over singing. It's almost like you got, you know, how you rock your little baby and tell them you love them. Man, I tell you what, that usually puts them kids to sleep.
Oh, yeah.
No matter how they've been wild and stuff, it's something about that comfort, something about that soft, soothing voice that says, you know what, and you look down, and sometimes the little kids kind of drift off, and they have a little smile on their face, you know, what they're dreaming about, but they drift out because they know they're safe. And that's what people want in this world today. They need to know they're safe and they're loved. That's what turns lives around.
Amen.
That's what turns it around.
Amen. Thank you,
hallelujah.
Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Someone else. Yes.
Well, here. Let me tell you what the Lord's done to me. I got healed. I got the confirmation. I got healed of type 2 diabetes yesterday.
Hallelujah.
Of course, it's anticlimactic because everybody's heard about it by now here. But, you know, I had prayed that even if the Lord didn't heal me, that I would have the anointing to be able to pray for other people and see them healed of diabetes. Because, you know, when you get it, you find out all the complications of it, how horrible it is as a disease. But, so, when I got my A1C back in July, they said it was 8.0. They said it was high enough, you know, it's going to take years for you to get it down. And they just wanted me to get it down to 7. So, and the medicine they gave me, it passes right through my system. I took 3-4 pills the other night, and 3 of them showed up the next morning in the toilet, so passing straight through my system. So it's not doing any good. The doctor thinks it is. But I got my A1C yesterday. It was down to 5.3, which is below pre-diabetes.
Hallelujah.
That's God. I've had high cholesterol for years, and they want to put me on an inhibitor because they're concerned about heart attacks and strokes. Because according to my doctor, I still have diabetes. But I don't receive that or accept it. Especially since my blood's normal. You know, I know God's given me a new pancreas. But it was funny because I've had high cholesterol, and she wanted to put me on an inhibitor. I said, well, what do my numbers look like there? She said, well, your triglycerides have come down from 233 to 139 in 3 months.
Woo!
Wow.
And your, but I forget what level it is. She wants me at 100 is what she wants me at. I said, well, what's that now? She said 102. I said, let's wait 3 months. We'll see what it is.
Hallelujah.
So, yeah, praise God.
That's right. Hallelujah.
Yes.
That's God. And that's Peter, it's great to share that because that's what God's doing.
Amen.
You know, he's the God that heals. And he's still working.
Yes.
You know, the same Jesus. I love that. Like the same Jesus.
Yeah,
the same Jesus. You know, is coming back one day. The same Jesus that healed then, healing now. He hasn't quit healing.
And now I want to start seeing more and more people healed of diabetes. You know, the devil hits me, I'm going to hit back even harder in the spirit.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Anyone else? Yes.
I do have a prayer request too. So God gave me this new job. It's not working out exactly as I'd hoped it would. A lot of stress there. I've got a lot more patience with them than I think they have with me. You know how that is.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's been a challenge, but I know what God told me. God, I believe, told me that I'm supposed to, my first focus is supposed to be doing what he's called me to do.
Hallelujah.
But that's been a challenge when I've got all of these demands at work that all of a sudden, out of nowhere, you know, you've got to have this done tonight, or you've got to have this done tomorrow morning by 7:30 in the morning. So I just, you know, I'm praying for favor. I just need grace with them.
Yes.
You know, this job will not be what I do the rest of my life, but you know, I got to pay the bills for now.
Yep. And we'll definitely pray because sometimes it's a stepping stone.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, I tell the students a lot of times, opportunities create are the opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen that happen. You just do what God's called you to do at this moment, and somebody pick up on that. Because I tell you what, he can send a call out of nowhere, basically, you know, and it's people see your work and they like your work, and somebody talks and says this and this, and you know that's God's working.
Absolutely.
And it's God's working. He can give you a better opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the reason I'm where I'm at in my career is because a friend of a church took me over to this place to start driving trucks.
Yeah.
Little did I know that would lead me to drive for Walmart, and I was there 22 years. I didn't know at the time, and I drove all night a lot of times, you know, but I just realized starting there and being faithful in those little things.
Yeah.
Open, and that was years down. It was 5 years, but it was years down the line. But you know what? You be faithful because God understands your heart.
Yeah.
And sometimes the best thing for us to do is not complain where we're at. I mean, that's hard because sometimes it's a hard situation. But I always say, you know, for us, we got to stop complaining and start proclaiming what God has said because that's what turned that situation around.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Yeah, I looked up Cindy. She's getting fatigued. Weariness of the coughing and her oxygen level's been down under 90 a couple times. We're just waiting for the manifestation of her healing. We're believing in it and waiting on it. And I know she's watching right now, editing as we go along with the broadcast here and stuff. So keep her lifted up and stand with her and believing in the healing that she will and has received. So.
Amen.
Yeah, we definitely will do that. That's what we're here for.
Amen.
All right. Anybody else? We'll just go ahead and stand and pray. Let's stand and pray. Father God,
thank you, Jesus.
You are a wonderful God.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
Without you, where will we be?
Thank you.
God, we know that healing, that healing that you've done, and already we're going to claim that.
Yes, Lord.
We're already going to claim the victory.
Yes.
Because God, you are that good. We thank you for moving in Peter's life. We thank you for healing that diabetes situation. We thank you because we know it was you. This job situation, Lord, that Lord, you can work it all out so that you're going to get the glory out of it. That the opportunity will come to Peter, that he will know because he loves you. That God, that door is open and it's time for me to step through. Father God, we thank you for James and that whole situation that you're going to take care of. Lord, we thank you for his friend, Jenny Humphrey, that always showed love because that's what it's about. Lord, we ask you to be with the ones that was unable to be here tonight, that you would touch their lives. Lord, that you would watch over them. Father God, we want to thank you for all your goodness. We want to thank you for protecting us throughout the week. We want to thank you for everything that you've done for us.
Yes.
Lord, we want to thank you for your goodness. We thank you for being our Holy Father. We thank you for being our wonderful counselor, the one that can change our lives. Father God, we ask you in this house of yours tonight, house of God, because we know it's a holy place because you are here. Lord, we ask you, Lord, that when we leave this place, we will not be the same, that you would stir up our hearts. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, that you would just, like they said, like a fire shut up in my bones. That, Lord, let us realize that without you, where would we be? Because, Lord, it's all about you. Let us never forget that. It's all about you. And Lord, we surrender every area of our life to you, that you can use us, whether it be at the grocery store, whether it be at the schoolhouse, wherever it may be, that people will see that you live in us. They will see, hallelujah, that our faces will shine, that we got a different attitude, that there's something different about us. We sound different. We act different. Why? Because we are different. Because you created us. Hallelujah. All things have passed away. All things become new in you. It's all about in the beginning, God. Let us never forget that. Touch our lives. Touch us from the top of our head to the sole of our feet. Because, Lord, we're here to praise you. As Psalms 34:1 says, I will bless the Lord at all times. At all times, good times, bad times, no matter what times there may be. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. And tonight, as we go further into service, let us realize just how good you are and how great a God we serve. In your wonderful holy name, we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you have a cell phone, please turn it off or put it on vibrate. Now, we are going to speak the word. Hallelujah. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Hallelujah. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Brother Peter, would be so kind to take the offering tonight, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We're just so thankful and so grateful for all you do in our lives. For your word says, Lord, that you give us the ability to get well. Father, in Jesus' name, now each and every one of these lives, Lord, grant them overwhelming and exceeding favor and give them God ideas and God dreams. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Bless you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. Let's worship the Lord right now. Thank you, Jesus. We bless you today. Thank you, Father, for your great gift of love. Thank you, Lord, for healing Peter. Thank you, Lord, for the continuing work that you're doing in his life. We thank you, Lord, that you'll use him to heal others. He has experienced your love in a very profound way, and he'll now be able to share that with others, Lord. And it's all you. It's all your work. And we thank you for it, Lord. Every good and perfect gift comes down from you, the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness nor shadow of turning. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Everything that you've ever done, you're still doing today and will continue today to do throughout all of humankind's life. And we thank you for it in Jesus' mighty and precious name. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Tim. Praise the Lord. Appreciate you opening and sharing what was on your heart. And it's I'm grateful that it's also what I want to speak on tonight. Amen. I'll just basically expand a little bit on what Tim's already said. So praise the Lord. The Spirit is one. Amen. And so he speaks to us all. Amen. To the Spirit. Deep calleth unto deep. Amen. And we're going to have a little celebration for our brother James's birthday. So I hope everybody can stay for just a few minutes at least and have a little cake and wish him a happy birthday and a great upcoming year. And just believe that God's going to bless him and open some doors for him, and that he'll see the hand of God moving and working in his life. And we thank the Lord for James. Amen.
Amen.
He is a gift from God. Praise the Lord. So we're looking forward to spending a little time with him. Yeah, give Jim a hand. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Happy birthday, James. We'll have a chance so everybody can share with you a little bit as soon as the service is over. I'm going to be very brief tonight for that very purpose, so that we can spend a little bit of time with James and let him know how much we care about him and appreciate him being a part of our lives. Amen. And I love to give homemade gifts, James. So, which one of my kids do you want? Okay, well, we'll talk about it afterwards. Praise the Lord. Amen. God's good, right?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So let's go right to this. Ephesians chapter 4, and I'd like to read verses 13 through 18. Ephesians 4, verse 13 through 18. Am I on here? I don't even know if I turned my mic.
I'm trying to get there. Ephesians 4.
No, I wasn't sure if I even turned my mic on. So.
Ephesians 4, 14 through 18?
4, 13 through 18, please. Chapter 4, verses 13 through 18.
Okay. Trying to get all my hats on here.
Praise God. You know, Tim was talking about how we do have an instantaneous salvation in terms of being born again the moment we receive Christ and trust in his finished work. But there is a process from there that we become Christ-like, that we actually begin to manifest Jesus in our lives. And that's what I want to talk to you very briefly about this evening, and just basically carry on a little bit beyond what Tim has already spoken. So, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, under the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. This I say therefore, and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. So, in spite of how it might seem,
Christian, and you can almost use those terms interchangeably, Christianity and spirituality, if it's true Christianity. But in spite of how it might seem, Christianity or spirituality, however you want to define it, isn't a set of beliefs or a list of prohibitions and obligations or spiritual self-improvement.
No.
Christianity, spirituality, is a journey. It's a journey toward becoming one with God, mm-hmm. becoming like God, becoming the manifestation of God in the earth, the body of Christ. Amen?
Yes.
And I think it's simplistic to think or even to suggest that this oneness with God is developed in the first minutes of conversion. There's a change that takes place. We're transformed. Our spirit is made brand new,
mm-hmm.
like His.
Mm-hmm.
But our minds have to be renewed.
Uh-huh.
Right.
And everything externally flows from how our minds operate.
Uh-huh.
So however you think is how you basically are going to act.
Mm-hmm.
Without a thought, you can't do anything. So it's important then that we think in agreement with the Word of God so that our behavior then will also manifest that reality. Amen? So instant familiarity produces pseudo-intimacy, whether it's with God or whether it's humans. We all heard about, you know, love at first sight. To me, and I mean, I know sometimes that works out, but the reality is what instant familiarity or, say, you know, love at first sight is actually phony intimacy or pseudo-intimacy. It's not true intimacy because
no.
you don't even know the person.
Exactly.
You like the external look. You like what you see, but that doesn't mean anything long-term.
Right.
Relationships that involve genuine intimacy take time and shared experience.
Yes.
That's why, you know, the longer you're with somebody and you have children or don't have children or whatever it is, but the longer you spend with somebody, the more intimacy becomes a natural
mm-hmm.
outgrowth of that. And I'm not talking physical, you know, sexual. I'm talking about true intimacy where you really understand each other, where you kind of interact with each other without having to use a lot of verbiage all the time, not having to talk all the time, but you just have that comfort
mm-hmm.
with each other. Amen. You know how they feel about things. They should know how you feel about things.
Exactly.
Without having to go through a long litany of everything every time something comes up, that, oh, yes, I understand and I agree and on and on and on and on. I'm not good at that, so that's why I'm really declaring this to be a reality. But I'm just saying, the longer you're with somebody, the less words you need. I'm not saying you don't need to talk, but I'm saying that you really don't need to spend a lot of time explaining things that have already been resolved over 25, 30 years or longer, you know? Knowing somebody, not knowing about them, demands spending time together.
It does. It
just requires closeness. Amen?
Amen?
And again, not just conversational, but being with them, passing time. Passing time uncluttered by words.
Right.
You know, it's like a good friend, a buddy. You can go out and go fishing with him and not say more than four or five words. But you're good friends, you know, you just feel comfortable with each other. You don't have to go on and on and on and share everything and explain everything and talk. You know what I'm saying? You're just good, you know. If you feel like talking, you talk. If you don't, you don't worry about it. And that's true with God as well.
Amen.
Studying God's character doesn't necessarily produce friendship with God. We all have known about, at least, theology professors and others who know all about God,
right.
but have absolutely no intimacy with Him whatsoever.
Exactly.
They can tell you about the character of God, but they can't tell you about the relationship that is needed with God. Amen?
Amen.
Spending time working for God doesn't produce intimacy with God.
No, it doesn't.
Praise the Lord. Let's look at this familiar scripture here in Luke chapter 10, verse 38 through 42. And it's the story of Martha and Mary. And, you know, Martha's all busy. She's you know, whipping up the dinner and trying to make everything just right for Jesus and fixing the food that she thinks he'll like and enjoy, and maybe she already knew those things that he liked and she was getting prepared and doing all of that for her. And Mary's just sitting there listening to Jesus speak about the goodness of God and God's love and God's grace and mercy. So now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. She had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came to him and said, "Lord, dost thou not care my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me." And Jesus answered and said unto her, "Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. But one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her."
Amen.
So what Jesus wanted was her friendship. Service would come as a result of that relationship, but not to develop the relationship or not to establish the relationship. It shouldn't, works ought to come out of the relationship we have with God, but they shouldn't replace the relationship that we have with God.
Right.
All right, John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus saith unto him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Now that he says, "I am the way."
Right.
And we're talking about a journey, right? And this is the way Jesus always related to people. "I am the way." Christianity was originally referred to as the way. The way. Amen. Acts chapter 9, verse 2. Paul's talking about when he was given license basically to go out and harass and arrest and persecute and prosecute Christians. This is the way he's talked about it. "I desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogues that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem." Mm-hmm. All right, Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. "And he saith unto them, Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." So this image of a journey points out Christians aren't commanded to just go somewhere or to just do something, but they're invited to follow Jesus. Or actually, the literal translation would be to travel with Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The implication is we share his life. Romans 8, 17. "If children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together."
Mm-hmm.
All right, Hebrews 12, 10. "For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness." So here's what I get from that. My suffering, in some mysterious way, is his suffering. My holiness is his holiness.
Yes.
Yeah.
If we're identifying with him,
yes.
If we understand that, he shares my life with me, and I share his life. Praise the Lord. And he promises to be with me always. Praise the Lord. So it's more than just when we talk about being one with God. Jesus literally wants to live out a life through us. And he wants us to live our life in him.
Amen.
That's where the oneness comes from. That's where the identity of unity with God and being one with Christ is, that when we suffer, he suffers with us.
Yes.
Amen. It's his suffering. And when he's holy, it makes me holy.
Yes.
Come on.
Because we can't be separated. We're one. We are one and the same. Amen. So he promises that no matter what I'm going through, whether it's suffering, whether it's being glorified, whether it's being blessed, whether it's the other, he's with me.
Yes.
It's all good. It's all the same because he's with me.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. This is an example of what I'm talking about. He says, I've got all power now. And the result of that is, go, then you go and do this. How are we going to do that if we're not one with him? He's got all the power, right?
Right.
He just told us that. All power is given unto him, heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatever I've commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. So that's validation of what I'm talking about. He has all power, and he tells us to go. Why? Because we can't go unless he's with us anyway.
Right.
He wouldn't tell us to go if he wasn't already in us.
Right.
We wouldn't have the ability to do any of the things that he commands us to do if he hadn't already, you know, shared that power with us, being one with him. Amen. So the journey that we take with Jesus is obviously not a journey through space.
Amen.
But it's a journey through time, through our lives,
yes,
throughout eternity, ultimately. But it's not a journey to a physical location. But it's a journey of transformation.
Mm-hmm.
It's a journey that transforms us into his image.
Yes.
And it never ends.
That's right.
In this life, it'll go like... like Tim said, it doesn't matter if you got saved at 10,
right,
or you got saved at 110.
Mm-hmm.
There's a journey. There's a process that takes place throughout that time. Now,
yes,
the 110-year-old may have more information and have more experiences to draw from, but it's still a process.
Yes.
He still has to get from the inside out.
Amen.
To manifest in any meaningful way, okay?
Amen.
So let's wrap this up with the last scripture, Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 13. Till we all come into unity. This is the goal. This is where he's trying to bring us to. So we all come into the unity of the faith, the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man. Anybody there yet? Not me. Praise the Lord. I'm not as imperfect as I once was, but I'm still imperfect. I'm still not perfect. But I'm on a journey. I'm in a process. And God has declared me righteous,
yes,
through this process. So I can't fail.
Right.
Amen. Knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That's the goal.
Yes.
We may not achieve it totally in this life, but we will. We will achieve it at some point, because
yes,
we'll lay aside,
yes,
this mortal coil, this thing that is drawn to sin and responds to sin, to a place of where the flesh is as pure and as righteous as the spirit. That's that born again, that's that new creature. That's the thing that groans within us, wanting to be made in the image, wanting spiritually we're already done. But physically, we have to get a new body, that's flesh and bone, one that can be sinless, just like our spirit man. Amen? So it's a journey of growing into the fullness of Christ, and it's a progressive union with God.
Amen.
Amen? Spiritually, we're perfect. We are one with God. We are one with Christ. But in the natural, there's a journey. There's a process that takes place. And that's the more we surrender to the love of God, the more we become like God, the more,
amen,
we're capable of sharing that love with other people so that they can experience the same reality of God in their life that we have.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give him a hand. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. All right. God bless everybody. Let's go downstairs and spend a little time with James. Wish him a happy birthday. Have a cupcake or whatever. And just have a few minutes together in fellowship and share the love of Christ with James. Amen. That would be a good thing. God bless all of you. Father, just bless the food and all, everybody that partakes of it. Bless James. And give us a time of fellowship here, and let James understand and realize how much we care about him and how much, more importantly, you care for him.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name. Amen. Go downstairs and have a bite to eat. Hallelujah.